Peter Simple by Frederick Marryat. The book is preceded by a song written by David Garrick. Come cheer up, me lads, 'tis to glory we steer, to add something new to this wonderful year. To honour we call you, not press you like slaves, for who are so free as the sons of the waves? Heart of oaks are our ships, heart of oak are our men, we always are ready, steady, boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again. We ne'er see our foes, but we wish them to stay. They never see us, but they wish us away. If they run, why we follow and run them on shore. For if they won't fight us, we cannot do more. Heart of oak are our ships, heart of oak are our men. We always are ready. Steady, boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again. They swear they'll invade us, these terrible foes. They'll frighten our women and children and beaux. But should their flat bottoms in darkness get o'er, still Britons they'll find to receive them on shore. Heart of oak are our ships, heart of oak are our men. We always are ready, steady, boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again. We'll still make them run and we'll still make them sweat, in spite of the devil and Brussels Gazette. Then cheer up, me lads, with one voice let us sing, our soldiers, our sailors, our statesmen and king. Heart of oak are our ships, heart of oak are our men, we always are ready, steady, boys, steady. We'll fight and we'll conquer again and again. Chapter 1. The great advantage of being the fool of the family. My destiny is decided, and I'm consigned to a stockbroker as part of His Majesty's seized stock. Unfortunately for me, Mr. Handycock is a bear, and I get very little dinner. If I cannot narrate a life of adventurous and daring exploits, fortunately I have no heavy crimes to confess, and if I do not rise in the estimation of the reader for acts of gallantry and devotion in my country's cause, at least I may claim the merit of zealous and persevering continuance in my vocation. We are all of us variously gifted from above, and he who is content to walk instead of to run on his allotted path through life, although he may not so rapidly attain the goal, has the advantage of not being out of breath upon his arrival. Not that I mean to infer that my life has not been one of adventure. I only mean to say that in all which has occurred, I have been a passive rather than an active personage, and if events of interest are to be recorded, they certainly have not been sought by me. As well as I can recollect and analyze my early propensities, I think that, had I been permitted to select my own profession, I should in all probability have bound myself apprentice to a tailor, for I always envied the comfortable seat which they appeared to enjoy upon the shop board, and their elevated position, which enabled them to look down upon the constant succession of the idle or the busy, who passed in review before them in the main street of the country town, near to which I passed the first 14 years of my existence. But my father, who was a clergyman of the Church of England, and the youngest brother of a noble family, had a lucrative living, and a soul above buttons, if his son had not. It has been from time immemorial the heathenish custom to sacrifice the greatest fool of the family to the prosperity and naval superiority of the country. And at the age of 14 I was selected as the victim. If the custom be judicious, I had no reason to complain. There was not one dissentient voice when it was proposed before all the varieties of my aunts and cousins, invited to partake of our New Year's festival. I was selected by general acclamation. Flattered by such a unanimous acknowledgement of my qualification, and a stroke of my father's hand down my head which accompanied it, I felt as proud, and alas, as unconscious as the calf with gilded horns, who plays and mumbles with the flowers of the garland which designates his fate to everyone but himself. I even felt, or thought I felt, a slight degree of military ardour and a sort of vision of future grandeur pass before me, in the distant vista of which I perceived a coach with four horses and a service of plate. It was, however, driven away before I could decipher it by positive bodily pain, occasioned by my elder brother Tom, who, having been directed by my father to snuff the candles, took the opportunity of my abstraction to insert a piece of the still-ignited cotton into my left ear. But as my story is not a very short one, I must not dwell too long on its commencement. I shall therefore inform the reader that my father, who lived in the north of England, did not think it right to fit me out at the country town near to which we resided. But about a fortnight after the decision which I have referred to, he forwarded me to London on the outside of the coach, with my best suit of bottle green and six shirts. To prevent mistakes, I was booked in the waybill, to be delivered to Mr. Thomas Handycock, No. 14 St. Clement's Lane, carriage paid. My parting with the family was very affecting. My mother cried bitterly, for like all mothers, she liked the greatest fool which she had presented to my father, better than all the rest. My sisters cried because my mother cried. Tom roared for a short time more loudly than all the rest, having been chastised by my father for breaking his fourth window in that week. During all which my father walked up and down the room with impatience, because he was kept from his dinner, and, like all orthodox divines, he was tenacious of the only sensual enjoyment permitted to his cloth. At last I tore myself away. I'd blubbered till my eyes were so red and swollen that the pupils were scarcely to be distinguished, and tears and dirt had veined my cheeks like the marble of the chimney-piece. My handkerchief was soaked through with wiping my eyes and blowing my nose before the scene was over.
My brother Tom. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.